Hello, hello, hello! This is your favorite video series, Get Ready With Me for the Holidays, Day 5. Let's take a step back and reflect a little bit of what are the things I learned in 2020 despite all the craziness of this year. I've actually learned some things. Let's get started. Top 3 things I learned in 2020 was actually from a program I participated in the company, and I had my accountability partner in my team. Top 3 things I learned from this program called Fast Forward. This is a program that's focused on personal and professional improvement, leadership development, and it was actually founded by 2 co-founders, Lisa McCarthy and Wendy Lashgold. Those two have years of experience working in corporate, and they shared the tips and tricks and some suggestions or actionable steps that you can actually take to improve, to get to the next level, and to be happy in general. The program itself inspires people to dramatically change what they see possible and change their limiting mindset to chase after their goals and dreams with intentions and discipline. And if you wanted to know more about how to get involved in the program, I'll link their website below and the ways to get involved. Now that I'm sharing 3 things I learned from the 7-week program with my accountability partner. The first thing, first ever thing, is to manage your inner critics and to overcome the imposter syndrome. And you might be wondering, what is imposter syndrome? Imposter syndrome is a psychological pattern where the individuals doubt their skills, talent, and accomplishment, and has this constant fear of being doubted as a fraud, and they can't do anything. So basically, if you visualize people who has imposter syndrome will think that, for example, this is a circle that they know and this is a circle that other people know. So basically, they think what they learn is definitely not enough compared to what other people learn. And in reality, those 2 circles are not that drastic. So it's almost like all different types of almost average sized little circles, sometimes overlapping with each other. You might have other knowledge that people also share. There's overlaps, there's other things that you know that other people does not know, but it's not that of a drastic difference if you think about average people. And everyone can have imposter syndromes. No matter how much they achieved in a year, people will still think, I'm not enough, I'm not good enough. So it's a very common psychological pattern that everyone might fall into. And me personally, I've had imposter syndromes as well. But over the years, I try to convince myself and try to step out of the circle that I know that more focused on self-improvement instead of, oh, this is what I know and I can't improve, or other people definitely know more about me, or I'm not eligible enough, I'm not good enough. So that those doubts, those inner critics will be the first step that we need to work on. So that's the first step to manage your inner critics. Keep yourself more objective in terms of your qualifications, your achievements, your talents. Think about your interview someone and all your things, your talents, what you can do is on a piece of paper. If you don't know this person is actually you, you will think, huh, this person is qualified for a seat at the table, for this job, for that stretching projects. Keep an objective view on yourself is the first lesson I learned from this program. Manage my inner critics, talk to myself. Don't let the voice of you're not good enough dominate every day. So that's one, manage your inner critics. And step 2 is build a bold vision of what you can be, or imagine yourself in 5 years, 3 years, what do you want to be? Close your eyes and start visualizing those little, tiny little details. It's a year from now, you get up, and what room are you in? What clothes are you wearing? Which train are you taking? Are you driving to work? Are you getting a cup of coffee? And when you get to the desk, what's your environment? Who are your coworkers? What's your priorities for the day? A year from now on. And that, when you have a clear, bold vision and attention to those little details, you will actually start, your mind will start formulating those actionable steps to help you get there. Lessons 2 I learned from this program is have a bold vision. And step 3, I would consider last but not least, very important step, is to plan the work and work the plan. In the program, they suggest a 90-day action plan, whether it's a thing that you wanted to achieve another year or whether it's mental health status you wanted to be in a certain period of time. List 5 things or 3 things that is very actionable, very specific, with a timeline, and share it with your accountability partner so the person can help you, can be there when you're feeling vulnerable. But definitely keep the steps very actionable, very specific. Instead of having, say for example, if it's your personal health, you wanted to lose weight, you wanted to lose 3 pounds by end of this year or by first quarter, second quarter, then don't use that as your actionable steps, because that's just a goal or target, very generalized. Instead, switch the actionable goals to having enough water, having 8 cups of water every day. That's an actionable step versus very generalized, you just want to lose weight. So that first 3 lessons I learned in 2020, all coming from this Fast Forward program. I highly recommend anyone who's interested, check out their website and see how you can get involved. Number 4 of the things I learned in 2020 is the importance of having a routine. Since March, we've started work from home. Until the end of the year, we're still remotely working and we're missing that traffic. I'm not saying I miss the traffic. I'm just saying missing the steps of commuting from one place to the other. And I actually was listening to audiobooks and listening to the podcast and maybe bring a physical book or my Kindle with me to read on the subway. And that 20 minutes or 30 minutes pieces of time was actually helpful, very helped me to achieve my book list or get myself informed on a lot of things around us. So without that, in the first month or two, we're still transitioning to this new normal of working from home. So a lot of the routines are kind of blended together. When you get up in the morning, if you're me, I'm actually working in my bedroom, set up my workstations here. So it's really just very close to the bed, and it's a lot of things to adjust and how to draw that boundaries of leaving work and have a fresh mind when you get home so you can do the things you plan to do. It's tricky, it's very hard, and how to kind of still keep the work-life balance, or more importantly, how to get yourself motivated to work in the morning versus your bed is right next to you. The things I learned in this year is to still keep a part of your routine, not necessarily the traffic part. I'm not letting you to drive 20 minutes and then drive back just to get into that mindset. I'm talking about the simple things like the morning cup of coffee, or maybe the way how you set up your workstation, clean your workstation a little bit, or pick out your favorite piece of earring to wear that day, just to make yourself adjust to the work mode versus you're probably wearing pajamas 5 minutes before work. The flexibility part in 2020 was actually I can squeeze in a short walk in the middle of the day during lunch hour. Before that, it's barely possible that you do that. But now the schedule's a little flexible, so I can do a little walk when I need to clear my mind for something important. So that's number 4, what I learned in 2020, is to the importance of having a routine, building that new routine to adjust to this new normal. Things number 5 that I learned in 2020 is the importance of your body gesture in the Zoom calls, in the office meetings, since it's all virtual now. So the way you pose yourself to the camera, because it's instead of meeting in person, a lot of the body gestures won't come through your tiny little screen. So the way you pose yourself, use your lighting, or the angle you're putting your cameras on are very important, became more important versus in-person meetings. So virtual meetings, I learned that the camera or the device that you're using varies from person to person. So your little camera there, try to talk to the camera itself instead of staring somewhere else. If your camera is on the top of your screen, don't stare at the screen, instead stare at the camera, so that the audience or the person who's having meetings with you will feel like you're actually talking to them. Similar to I'm recording now, instead of looking at the screen, I would look at the camera directly to you, so I'm looking into your souls. No, I'm looking so that I give you attention, I give you my full attention that I'm talking to you, I spend time with you. So that's kind of the respect part of the Zoom meetings, of the virtual meetings, what I learned. And a lot of times you see people, if there's a person or a speaker is constantly, say, twisting the person's chairs, like, or like unconsciously, they're just like swing left, swing right. It's very distracting, because a lot of times if you know that the three V's of the message across, 55% is all visual. Like the message you're transforming from the remote meetings, 55 of them are visual signals. So if you're constantly rock back and forth, people will think, oh, you're just impatient, you don't want to talk to me anymore. But instead, the person might be just be nervous. So the things that you can overcome that is, or adjust better to show respect, show more respect, and be effectively communicating without any body language distractions, is actually lean your body weight in the front, adjust your chair, use only a third or half of the chair instead of lay back. So all your body weight is on the back, so it's kind of like lay back and disengage. But instead, adjust your body weight to the front and put your two legs and lay the body weight in the center of your body and kind of lean forward. In this way, you got support maybe from your arms, kind of rested on your table, but this way your body wouldn't feel unbalanced, so that you start to shake your legs or swing back and forth. That's all because of your body weight, it's not leaning forward. So the word of leaning actually means that you adjust your body weight to the front so that audience will feel like you're fully engaged, I'm here listening to you. So that's lesson number 5, your body gesture matters. Number 6, things I learned in 2020 is actually I started a habit of jotting down, write down some of the things or key messages I read about an article, a book, or the things I'm working on. I started to take digital notes instead of having a notebook and write physical notes on it. And later on, I'll still need to transform in a digital way. So this year, I started to use a lot of note-taking techniques. And if I'm reading a book, then maybe I'll type in some of the key points that I learned or some of the sentences I really like. And that kind of serves as a mental reminder or digital reminder to be helpful later on if you wanted to, say, tell your friends that, oh, I read this awesome book. And the next thing you know, you have this list of 20 things why you like this book, and you can just maybe send your friend, say, hey, this is 20 things I learned from the book, definitely check out that book. So it's very helpful for you to form your takeaways, your summary of the book, your articles, and later on, if you are also creating contents, you're writing your blogs, or you're having your channels, those are the things naturally becomes your talking point that you can use. And it only takes a minute more than you normally would just scan through, and every other content kind of blended together and you lost your key takeaways of the book. So that's something I learned in 2020. Number 7 things I learned in 2020 is the importance of visualizing your dream or your goals. Kind of linked to the top 3 things I learned from the Fast Forward program, I started to create my own vision board. Because a lot of things, once you see it, then you have the foundation to believe that those things can actually happen, or change your mindset of limitations. You set those limitations you set for yourselves, break those barriers and see those things and act on it. So I started this vision board project with my husband, and both of us draw down, here's the current state and here's why we're not satisfied, say for example for some things, and current state. And another part of the board is the future state that you wanted to get to, whether it's a year from now or 6 months from now, and just draw it, like how maybe you're happy or maybe you're stronger or maybe a lot of things that you don't have now or things you're not cherishing enough in the future, highlight those things. So from the current state to the future state, we both write 3 major things that will help you visualize and achieve or remind yourself how you can get from the current state to the future state. It's actually draw it, believe it, act on it. So those are the 3 steps that can help you visualize and believe and actually take actionable steps to bring things into fruition. So those are the things that we did. And surprisingly, when I look back at the vision board we created probably 6 months ago, 2 or 3 things actually achieved if I look at year end. And those are the things it's just my wildest dream, or the things that I wouldn't believe at that time if I didn't draw it. But now it's realized. So the power of vision board, the power of visualize your vision, it's definitely something I learned in 2020. For 8 things that I learned in 2020, this might be helpful if you're also in the stage of wanting to take on that stretching project, having the opportunities or having the drive to move your career to the next level, getting that promotion, getting that paycheck, getting that increase, getting that dream job that you want. That I learned from a training program that I actually provided in my company is how to take your career to the next level. Is there will be some critical moments that originally or currently you're thinking, oh, maybe this is the point that I should take a step back. I'm not senior enough. I'm the youngest person in the room, so I shouldn't say anything. I don't do things stupid. But those are the critical defining moments that if you want the career advancement, this is actually the exact moment you need to choose to lean in. You need to choose to say that one sentence that's in your mind, or say that stupid idea. I quote unquote stupid because you're again back to the imposter syndrome. The stupid idea you think might be the solution that the problem needs. So don't be afraid to say something, to vocalize your idea. Even though you're the youngest person in the room, definitely take that step and have that courage to choose to take a step up instead of lean back and take a step back. So those are the number 8 things I learned in 2020. Number 9 was actually inspired by my accountability partner. If you're watching this, thanks to you, that the people's emotion outlet on you. So a lot of times people are in challenging situations and they wanted to talk to you because of your good friend, good mother, good wife, good connection, and they trust in you. They kind of pour their negative feelings or their problems on you while you were nice and trying to guide them through the challenges hard in their life. And you probably didn't realize that those negative emotions also will impact you if you're not consciously manage those. So the critical thing is to manage those emotions that's not generated by you, but later on kind of poured on you or placed on you because you're that mentor role or you're that guidance role. And when those things come to you, it's not your problem, but other people's problem, but you listened in, absorbed in. The important thing is to manage that. It's emotions. Manage those from an objective way. Say, for example, you took a call and the person was clearly not in a good mood and might say something mean to you or say something that they didn't mean at that time, then take a step back, saying, analyze this in your mind, saying, is this person is really just having a bad day, instead of, oh, the person doesn't like me, or the person just wanted to hurt me. So instead, take that step back, and having that internal analysis is really helping you and helping you to kind of draw the line between your emotion and other people's emotion. Try not to let external emotion input to impact your internal emotion or mental health state. So that is very important. Maintaining your own mental health always trumps giving guidance, giving help to other people. Because if you're not even feeling happy or you're not even feeling motivated, how can you even help other people? So I think that's the key lessons I learned. Number 9 things I learned in 2020. Yes, a lot of people were having issues, were having troubles. It's challenging. It's very hard. It's very sad. We lost our jobs or a lot of things. But those things, in order to be here for your friend, for your family, for people you care about, be there for them, you need to manage your own mental health first and try to kind of manage the flow. You need to have your own emotion outlet, whether that's take a run or read a book or have some creation outlet for that. You need to find that balance for yourself before you even help others. Or don't like other people's problem became the single priority of your life, because that's just not helpful for both you and the person you're trying to help. That's number 9 things that I learned in 2020. And the last thing I learned in 2020 is from the experience I started my channel. If you like an active creator like me, you will probably have your app of YouTube analytics downloaded on your phone as well. So the landing page would be, oh, your latest video is ranking, based on views, it's ranking 1 out of 10 or 10 out of 10. And sometimes I would let that ranking be impacting my own like emotions of the day or certain point of the day. And now I learned in 2020 is to take a step back and start asking myself questions. Is those are the stats and analytic points that YouTube is set up for helping a creator analyze how good the video is, how the audience is reacting to your videos. But that's a tool, and don't let the tool to impact or be the sole determination point of whether you are happy about your content or not. It's really just a status of how well this video compared to other videos in this category, versus it doesn't take into account of, as a creator, how you feel about your movie or how well you feel, how you feel about your content. If you're totally happy of the content creation part or editing part, or you slam that joke in your video and you feel great about it. So that's, to me, it's a 1 out of 10 of my videos. So I almost doesn't care like whether it's ranking number 1 or number 10. If my goal for creating content is make myself happy, or along the way maybe help other people, instead of, oh, I wanted to be that number 1 on the list, or I wanted to be top 50. So it's a different goal. If your goal is not to achieve to the number 1 and you always wanted to beat other videos in the same category, you wanted to stand out and keep the retention very long, then maybe those status should be your golden or your Bible for guiding through the next video. But if your goal is really to have some fun along the way, then try not to internalize the stats a lot. So that's the last thing number 10 that I learned in 2020, and all the things I listed above, the three things I learned from fast forward and building the routine, the importance of body gesture, write down the notes, create a vision board and visualize your goal, that career advancement, manage other people's emotion outlet, and number 10, always remind yourself why you started. And all those lessons that I learned in 2020, I'm still learning them. It's just those things I started to realize that, oh, I should think this way. It's almost like a mindset shift, and it's not a short-term goal that once you hit that goal, you forget about it. It should be a long-term thing that I'm still working on, and I hopefully that inspires you to take a step back and looking forward to the new year, but think, oh, what are the things I learned in this challenging year? Okay, day 5, take a step back, reflect on the whole year, mission accomplished. Hope you enjoyed this video series of getting ready with me for the holidays, and check out this video to see how I make my classic blueberry muffin and send it to the people who I care, people around me, and check out this video to see how I organized kitchen cabinets. We'll see you next time. When you're feeling vulnerable.